I had expressed to the three of these fine gentlemen is, you know, I want to hear their take, and we've already covered this in you know, to a certain extent, but how do you respond to those people who, and those organizations, those entities that are fighting against you? How do you anticipate their opposition, and how do you respond to it? And, you know, Mike began, well, this effort, certainly observing what was happening in other states, but has been very involved in the effort in Washington, and certainly, you know, has helped formulate responses to opposition there. So, Mike, let me maybe ask you to first. You know, one of the things I think has been most shocking in the Washington effort is the opposition from some commercial news media, especially the Seattle Times, and the copy of the editorial that is in your packet is just the latest, you know, example of this. Is, you know, one of, if not the largest newspaper in the state, taking a position that is very opposed to this law and sort of diminishes the arguments of those who are making it. And I'm just curious as to, you know, what your sense is of how has your response been in Washington, and how would you respond better if you were, you know, revisioning this whole process?
I mean, to say that it was you know, a sad sort of commentary is, I think, putting it lightly. I mean, it was disgusting. I mean, it was really just very you know, disheartening. I mean, as you see, I mean, we have a dream team out in Washington State. I mean, we had Brian pushing this thing. We had a representative up the Grove who you couldn't ask for a better proponent, you aside. We have Kathy and WJEA who have done a phenomenal job putting everything together. And we actually had a fair share of support, it seemed. And when the Seattle Times came out with their editorial during our initial efforts, I think that was, you know, that was kind of the nail in the coffin. I mean, I really think in many ways that gave cover to the opponents of this bill in a way that they might not otherwise have, you know, had a comfort level with. You know, as far as responding to it, I mean, their main argument is one that we hear from, you know, not just commercial news media, but from school officials all the time, and is the whole notion that the school is the publisher of the paper. And really, the Seattle Times editorial, the original one, really took the tone that, you know, hey, we as professional reporters don't get to write whatever we want. Why should we allow students to do the same? And so, you know, which is just not what we're advocating for with these laws. You know, to respond to that, you know, Kathy and WJEA actually, you know, they've had, you know, I think face-to-face meetings, and certainly, you know, numerous emails and things going back and forth with the Seattle Times. I know we tried to work with some of the commercial or the newspaper press associations and stuff out there with mixed results. You know, I don't know that I have a magic bullet to this. I mean, I think, I don't know, Kathy, maybe you and Brian have some different ideas, but it seems to be kind of one person. I mean, it really seems to be the publisher, and
it's
which is just so sad.
Son.
The publisher's son, right. And, you know, he just has a bug up his, you know, bonnet. I don't know exactly how you fix that until he disappears.
Right. You know, it does raise the question, though, of anticipating who your opponents are. And Jim, I know you talked about that this morning a little bit. Part of your planning was thinking about who those opponents were. And maybe you can talk a little bit about that, as how you identified them in advance and how you prepared to sort of respond to them.
Well, we knew, obviously, it was going to be the school boards and the School Administrators Association. And just tried to figure what their main arguments would be. Tying their hands to make personnel decisions was sort of the broad thing that we had identified first. And of course, that was their lead argument. And you know, trying to anticipate what they might offer, if anything, as far as amendments to try to deal with that. which was to narrow the bill only to address situations that arose from the journalism teacher context, which would have created a very interesting situation with the California Teachers Association, because had we done that, we probably would have lost them as a co-sponsor. And so we really kind of had to dance on the head of a pin, so to speak. One of the things that I try to do, I mean, this is just my style of lobbying, and fortunately it's Senator Yee's style of dealing with situations as well, and that's to meet with opponents up front, which we did. We were in the Capitol basement with representatives from both ACSA and CSBA, and we just told them, this is what we want to do, this is kind of where we're headed, and... you know, get their take on it. And it was very interesting because it gave us an opportunity to sort of read their body language. And Senator Yee's staff member who was there, Adam, and I observed that even though they were making the arguments that we'd anticipated, they were uncomfortable making those arguments. It was like, oh, after we presented our case, we said, okay, there's 14 teachers that have been retaliated against, which was news to them. All right, this is the situation, all right? And especially the lobbyist for the school administrators, you could just see, she's like, oh, you know, I don't really want to oppose this bill, but, you know. And then I read that, I said, okay, well, that... this is going to go one of two ways. They're either going to really rally the troops and we're going to have some tremendous opposition on this, or it might be a little soft and it could result in some desperate types of things. I don't know how it's going to go, but we'll just kind of see what happens. And sure enough, in committee, the first committee hearing, the school administrator lobbyist got up and made the following statement. ACSA has heard of numerous situations whereby a teacher has used poor judgment under the guise of student freedom of speech. And Senator Yee, on his feet, just kind of pointed out, well, if they had known about these situations, they would have brought them forward. And that really kind of helped blunt that initial momentum that they were trying to build upon. And as luck would have it, you know, this lobbyist went first in testimony in opposing the bill. And then when the CSBA lobbyist got up to testify on the bill and started in on some more cogent arguments, I thought the stronger arguments, which were, you know, that it was a little broad. By that time, the senators in the committee had enough. And he was prepared to bring his legal counsel up to start arguing the law and so forth and so on. And they just cut him off. Before the legal counsel even got a chance to start in, I remember Senator Kuehl said, you know, the only thing that's brought about this bill are the opposition's arguments. And so at that point, I knew that we had the votes to get it out of committee. It was just a matter of how many. And so, you know, it's just one of those things. You know, I've told Mark before, you know, sometimes it's I'd rather be lucky than good, you know, and I think this is just one of those kinds of situations where it happened. You know, just another quick illustration, we were doing the Hoste bill with Senator Yee. We had made the determination to go forward pretty quickly after the decision was made, and Senator Yee committed and said, yeah, let's do it. We're going to make a strong statement. California is going to be the first state that comes out. And, you know, I'm starting to think about opponent arguments then, you know, and what they're going to raise and that kind of thing. And just as we were getting ready to put the bill into language, the memo from the general counsel came out. I was like, thank you. You know, and that gave us our launch pad. You know, so again, timing is part of that. All right. The other thing that we noticed in that meeting in the basement, meeting with opponents prior to the bill's progression, was that they were unlikely to offer up any amendments that we could take. I mean, when we started talking about the bill, they didn't fully understand what the protections in existing law for students were at the time. they were making statements like, well, you know, of course, where was it? Of course, students, you know, have to be limited in what they can say. You know, you can't take that away from administrators. And we had to point out, well, there is this education code section that's been in place since 1977. And indeed, they can be limited with regard to the students. And so even at that point, with the experts from both of these groups, they still didn't have an understanding of the California law. And so we began that education process. And of course, that was fun for Adam and I because we got to watch them wrench even more when they figured out that there was some statutory leverage that we had as well. Ultimately, we ended up taking some amendments to narrow the bill, which we had talked, we knew that we were going to have to take them. It was just a matter of when, and we tried to hold off as long as we could because we knew we were going to have to negotiate at some point, probably with the governor. And we were going to try to hold off as long as we could because at some point, you know, you're going to have to give something up in order to get something. And we wanted to wait until the very last minute to do that. If we did it too early, then that meant by the time it got to the governor, we would have to give up something else. And there wasn't really much more that we wanted to do. We wanted to give up. You know, it's kind of violating the lobbyist credo, I guess. Because you're always told, you know, don't fall in love with your bill. You know, you write this great piece of legislation, this great work, and it does everything, you know. But, you know, there's a certain amount of flexibility that you have to be ready to exercise. And sometimes you anticipate it, sometimes you don't. But I can talk about that a little bit later. What I'd kind of like to know, Leland, see, in California we have a law that lobbyists can't go on the floor or try to talk to members while they're on the floor for a vote. We can talk to them in committee. We can't go up on the dais, but we can talk to them in committee. We can try to pull them out and talk to them at the what we call a gate, all right? But we can't go on the floor. He can, obviously, because he's a member. And so if you're on the opposite side of an issue with a member, I mean, they can work the heck out of it, and you don't even know what they're talking about to folks. But I'm just kind of curious from Leland's perspective, were there any things that happened on the floor or in committee that you dealt with that we were not aware of outside?
No, I think on both bills, you know, there were pretty solid bipartisan support. You know, I think when we got into this particular issue, particularly the teacher protection bill, we made it very clear that while, you know, it was also to protect students' First Amendment rights, we kind of made it a labor issue. And in California, you know, labor plays very, very well. And so once we, you know, kind of let labor know that this was really about protecting your members and your employees, you know, we knew, I felt that we had a winner there because, you know, given all the members, you know, in both the Assembly and in the Senate, where the Democrats control both houses, we felt that we would, in fact, get the votes. What we were always worried about was to get enough Republicans so that the governor would not veto the bill. And I think Jim's correct. You know, what has to happen is that you've got to go into these battles with a clear mind that you've got to negotiate with the opposition. Because if you don't negotiate with the opposition, the worst thing for a member is to present a bill and the opposition says that, well, you know, we have some reasonable amendments and they wouldn't even talk to us about it. And that's just a killer. What we can always do is just say no to those amendments and say they're poor amendments, and then at least you can then say, well, we met and we just didn't think that the amendments were good amendments. Absent that argument, there wasn't a whole lot that the opposition can do to the bill. Now, one thing that I think Jim and my staff did a pretty good analysis where the opposition that came up towards the end that I did not expect was from the chairman of the Senate Education Committee. And that was the opposition we did not anticipate. And we had to make a conscious decision as to whether or not we want to roll a chairman. And, you know, as I said, you know, members don't roll chairs. But there are times when you want to, you know, take the chance, and you take a chance. And fortunately, he's a decent guy. And we're friends, and we're still colleagues and so on. He happens to be going to be the new chancellor for the community college system in the state of California. So you can kind of understand where his orientation was. But that was one opposition that we did not really anticipate. And he was really coy about it until the bitter end. And I think the way you handle these things is that, you know, before you go into battle, you've got to really marshal all the forces you can have, and just, you know, have it there, so that you can anticipate whatever the problems down the road. And because you've got to do that, because there are always going to be these little bumps along the road, and if you don't have all of your marbles on your side, then you may not have enough to finish to the goal line.
You know, Senator Yee, that actually raises a really good question. What is it that it takes to persuade someone who isn't necessarily on your side? I mean, you know, we've heard discussion of, you know, phone calls and visits. What do you think, in terms of priority, are the best sort of tactics to bring someone to the right position, that you know, both the lobbyist but also the constituent can do?
Well, you know, your best lobbyist for a bill is a member, and the best asset that a member has is the relationship that he or she may have with other members. You can get hundreds of calls, you can get hundreds of letters, but they pale compared to the ability or the relationship of a member going to another member and just sitting him down and say, you know, these are the reasons why. I think one of the reasons why we were successful in getting members to support our bills was the fact that, you know, this was the right issue. I mean, I don't understand how anybody can argue against our First Amendment. This is motherhood and apple pie, you know, for both Democrats and Republicans. So you cannot argue against it. I think there are some concerns about the responsibility of administrator, the importance of quality education standards, and so on. But the bill, our bill, really had nothing to do with that. It just really protects individuals' First Amendment. So if you can convey that to a member, member to member, you can get a lot done that way.
Getting as many co-sponsors as possible help in that way, would that give people ownership of the bill or not?
When you start out, you're not going to get a whole lot of co-sponsors, because this is a hot potato issue. People are going to, you know, sort of hide and whatnot. But having the ability of going to other members on your side and the other side, you just talk about these issues. And then also kind of prioritizing, you know, there are certain members that are a little bit more influential than others. And going to those members, that's extremely helpful too.
You know, I don't remember what state it was, but there at least in one state I remember where they did have a number of co-sponsors, and some of those individuals ended up voting against the bill, clearly not realizing what they were signing on to when they signed on to it, or having not received the opposition that they got afterwards.
For the college bill in Illinois that passed, I was telling Senator Yee earlier that bill just passed. We didn't even know it was even being introduced, and it passed without even a sweat. We didn't do squat. It passed, I think it had two votes against it in the House and none in the Senate. And as obviously you just said, several people said, well, how can anybody be against the First Amendment? But every time I would look at the progress of the bill, there was another co-sponsor added. So they just kept adding more and more co-sponsors.
Frank, could I just ask a follow-on? You heard the discussion in Washington about, you know, young people are eager to get involved and they're a resource that we can harness. And I'm just wondering, from the perspective of a member, what is the most effective way that young people as a resource could be utilized, and are there counterproductive ways? In other words, you know, showing up in mass at a hearing or blasting people with emails or holding a news conference at the Capitol, or, I mean, tactically, how would you use young people to the best effect?
For me in California, my best advice would be that if you've got a large group of young individuals, that they do the research, they analyze the profiles of different members and so on, and key in on a couple members and see whether or not you can get these members to be your advocates. I'm not sure that, you know, having a lot of emails and phone calls going into a member's office, you know, really does that. I think that members kind of pride themselves in looking at the quality of the argument rather than the number of arguments. But again, you know, if you can take the time to look at the profiles of different members to identify, you know, what members probably will like to take this issue up. Not necessarily to just author the bill, but to be an advocate and to help the author to move a bill. I think that would be tremendously helpful.
As a follow-up to that, let me ask, too, if in the California effort, the parents of high school students were galvanized or organized in some way. You certainly know that at a local school level, sports teams have parent booster clubs, the school band, other major constituencies, and they not only advocate it, but, you know, in a sense, they sort of stake out that turf. And I wonder if, in the case of California or in some other places, the role of the parents of these students to kind of step forward is utilized.
We didn't really have much from parent groups. They didn't really become that involved, but right. Just to follow up on Frank's question, we did have one student in particular who testified at the first hearing, went through the firing of her advisor when she was the editor-in-chief.
Yeah.
And her situation was probably one of the most compelling stories that could be told. Her advisor, the student newspaper had written a story about the use of long-term probationary teachers teaching all the AP classes at the school, and questioned the administration's authority to do it. And her advisor was fired for that story. And talking about that from a student perspective, I mean, it was the advisor that was harmed and everything else, but the chilling impact that it had on that newsroom after their advisor was removed and replaced with a brand new teacher, and their reluctance to really take on anything that was controversial or would have an impact at the school, I think really carried the day in that hearing. I mean, everybody that I could see, all the members were leaning forward, listening to her, which is a rarity in committee. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on in committee. They were really focused on her, and she was very articulate and able to tell the story. But that was far more effective than someone like me, who they see all the time up there.
Yeah.
Because she was directly affected by it.
One thing to suggest, I think, is actually really fascinating, is the idea that I think many of us who've been involved in the effort have thought about numbers. We have thought about getting more phone calls, more emails, lots of students to show up to a hearing, which probably does have an impact. But one thing I think in some places we haven't focused enough on is how well they understand the issue. I know there have been a couple places where there were hearings and there were accusations, at least, that the students really weren't especially prepared and especially good. And, you know, they said it's our First Amendment, period, and that was kind of the extent of their understanding of the argument. And it does suggest that we need to think about how to deepen the appreciation of it too. You know, Mike, I want to ask you, anything that you feel like you learned from the process in Washington in the, you know, 2 years that would, you know, starting fresh, you would do things differently, you know?
Well,
Well, you know, I was actually hoping to take advantage of our experts here as well, just to ask them, because I've had, you know, I've gone back in my mind just to figure out, kind of trying to figure out what we could have done differently. You know, the partisan poison in Washington State was incredible. I mean, what a lot of people don't know is we actually had Brian and Representative Upthegrove and I actually met early on with the Attorney General, or the State Assistant Attorney General in the state, and they were going to co-sponsor this legislation with us. And they were Republicans. Yeah, I should mention that. He was actually, this assistant AG was actually on his way to this to the first House hearing that we had to testify when, you know, as I understand it, he received a phone call from House leadership on the Republican side saying, don't do this because we are simply not going to support this and you're going to be out there all by yourself. You know, so one of the things that I would, you know, be very interested in hearing from you folks is, you know, how do you break through something like that? I mean, one of the things that, you know, I've wondered is if we inserted some language in our bill that talked about, you know, protecting religious expression in addition to, you know, just general expression. The other thing that was very dismaying to me was that, you know, I actually put together these long facts about why this legislation was important and what it did and didn't do. And, you know, Representative Upthegrove said, you know, that's great, but, you know, the members here, the only thing they're going to read are like five bullet points on a single piece of paper. You know, they don't even read the legislation. So, you know, a lot of this was just, you know, it was how do you break through when they just don't seem to even be open to you know, even listening?
Any ideas, Senator?
I would probably just ask the question about, you know, what sort of groups of individuals do you have really supporting? I mean, do you have labor on there? Do you have, you know, some of the ACLU types? And, you know, just trying to kind of understand your population and who will be able to tweak that population. You know, the number of votes that you need, the party representation of that sort of complex of votes that you're going to need. Who would be able to tweak and move, you know, these members. And that's how I would try to analyze it.
I mean, would something like adding something protecting religious expression? I mean, would that get people off the ball a little bit? Make it more difficult for them to vote against it?
You know, my concern is that whenever you try to do a bill, you try to you know be as clean as possible and not to load too much stuff into it, because you know there's that old adage that you know every action has a equal and opposite reaction. So if you add things in that you know it may sort of trigger other kinds of problems too. The best thing to do is to just kind of look at, you know, how many votes you need and, you know, who are those votes that you need, and then what are the different interest groups that can move these particular groups of individuals for those votes.
Yeah, just a couple of things to add to that. I think there's so much truth to what Senator Yee said about identifying the groups. But I think that using language like that may probably harm the bill's efforts because it may have a negative impact on the people that actually support it right now. And you don't want to do that either. And keeping it clean is one of the things that we really tried to do. In California, there's so much student speech activity that it's not difficult to find situations where students advocating a conservative issue on a conservative issue have somehow been harmed by prior restraint or censorship. And so, you know, it's easy to identify those issues. And so when that becomes an issue with conservative members or Republican members, you can just bring out that and say, look, this would protect this situation as well. And so rather than, you know, try to address a specific item in the bill by bringing up a situation that has occurred that would be protected under the bill. I think that was helpful on one hand, and it helped flip three Republican votes on the Assembly Education Committee. And you know, the Republicans in our legislature are what I call the Chamber of Commerce Republicans. They're going to defer to employers 10 times out of 10, whether they're, you know, right, wrong, or indifferent, because they're employers and that's their constituency, that's who they're going to back. And so one of the things that we had to deal with was the idea that, okay, we have public school employers, and while they may recognize the free speech and the student rights, you know, we still have to deal with the rights of these folks as employers. And that's where we looked at the existing law in California, and we were able to point out to each one of the members that had concerns that administration would still be able to exercise some control over student speech because we have built into our law protections for the principal or the administrator, as you well know, to exercise prior restraint if the speech is libelous, obscene, slanderous, or would create an imminent, you know, threat of a riot on campus, that kind of thing. And that gave them enough comfort, combined with the argument that this really is about accountability. I mean, these are public institutions, not private institutions. These are public institutions, and this is really about accountability for those public institutions. If somebody abuses their authority to make an employment decision, that should be known, and they should be limited in the law from doing that. And so that helped give them some comfort level with that as well. And we went from, I think it was a 4-3 vote in Assembly Education to 7-0 with those arguments.
I have a quick question. How many, I was wondering, you mentioned the teachers' unions. How much support have people gotten from either the teachers' unions or the teacher associations in the various states? That would be an interesting. Obviously, they're a very powerful lobbying group, no doubt. So I'm just wondering about that.
We asked them, and they said, we have our own issues. We don't want to cloud those issues. We're not going to stand in your way, but we're not going to get behind you.
In Michigan, sometimes fellow teachers don't like a free press. Mm-hmm. So that just isn't
unique to Michigan.
Yeah.
Isn't it really?
They don't like it even when there is a free press.
In Washington, they signed on as a member of our coalition, but they wouldn't make it a priority. But interestingly, the lobbyist for the Washington Education Association is a former student journalist. And so even though it wasn't a priority for her in Olympia, she was calling me on the phone, telling me what was going on, because she was personally really interested in it. But I think it's moving up on their scale, and because we've had issues where we have had teachers reassigned, we have, you know, have had things going on in our state where teachers are being retaliated against, and every time that happens, the union is contacted, and I think it's moving up on their list of priorities, hopefully.
Let me note too, one thing relating to that, one person we had hoped to have here but he couldn't schedule it was Rob Melton from Oregon, because many of you know Rob is very involved on the state basis but also nationally with the National Education Association, the big teachers union. He has gotten them to adopt a national resolution making student press freedom and free expression a priority, which in his mind he believes will help persuade the state chapters, which I guess it's all done on a state level, national doesn't get involved in lobbying like this, help persuade them that they should be involved in this as well. So, you know, one of the things I think we're going to do is help with Rob put together sort of, again, the case to make to your teachers' organizations about why they should be supportive of this effort.
That there are two.
Exactly.
Two groups.
Yes.
I'll just plug that resolution in the appendix of our book, Honesty Press.
Freshly out.
Yeah. Any final, Monica, comments or questions?
Well, I told Mark that I was having fun going through the files, and Mike, I found the bulleted item that was the only thing that the House members saw. And I think it's what we're finding out. It's so clear that every state is so different. And I think one of my favorite memories will always be in scholastic journalism over two states is the wonderful way the students handled the public hearing. And there weren't a ton of them. We had such good coaching by Bill Keller, and he made certain that they came in with, as he said, hat in hand and apologized for missing class that day. And it was just, and I had intended to speak on the Supreme Court, the background of this, and I remember the day we met for lunch before the hearing that afternoon. He said, Monica, please don't say Supreme Court. so every state is different. He said, let's not scare them with the word Supreme Court. I think that the approach is going to be so different.
It's true. And it suggests, again, how important it is that you find someone in your state who is that expert, who can provide that kind of guidance. You know, one of the things that I thought about, and everybody's pretty much said this, about the value of finding a very supportive author and someone who's got some influence with other legislators. As a voter, I don't have a clue about that. You know, you have to have someone who knows the legislature to be able to answer those questions for you. So,
lunch, I said, oh my God, any of our sponsors we've ever had never even came close to the level of understanding that he has on all of these issues. So,
I do appreciate the compliment, but I always say that you have to have experts to help you because it is because of Jim's knowledge of this particular issue that when other members raise some concerns as to why they could not support our bill, that we dispatch Jim over and to address those concerns, and that's really, really important. We're only the instrument. You all are the support to make things happen, and so you should not sort of belittle, the responsibility and the asset that you have. It is absolutely tremendous, and the relationship can only go so far. But if there's no substance behind the arguments and the bills and so on, then we would fall flat footed. So you all are so critical and important, and Jim's been just a star, in all of this effort, and I want to thank him for that.
Thank you, Senator.
I would like to ask a question to the group, but it's on something that I picked up from Jim's remarks. How in your, whether it was an effort that failed or an effort that was successful, was one of your strategies to sort of meet with your opponent so that you could figure out the lay of the land before you moved forward, so that you had an understanding of what hoops you had to jump through in order to pass the law?
For the lobbyists that we worked with helped us lay that out. They said, here's who's going to block you and why. So they helped us at least attempt to diffuse those arguments. Or in some cases, we had to go around them.
But you knew, at least knew going in which ones were going to be which.
Yes.
Okay. Did you actually meet with them and confront with them, as Jim was suggesting?
We did in some cases, and in some cases we didn't, again, on the advice of the lobbyist. We met with the education people, and that's when, as I just said, they said, we have our own issues, we're not going to call them, but we won't stand in your way. You can't use our lobbyist. But, so, in some cases we met, some cases
you know,
we
didn't. And I know in some states they've actually been fearful about approaching people with the presumption their opponents, thinking, well, maybe they won't be. And, there is a little bit of this sense, especially by the less politically sophisticated, that we don't want to, number one, tip our hand, and two, make people feel they're already pigeonholed in a particular position. So
the key to our success in Illinois in 97, when we succeeded, was that we actually got in Illinois. I found out then with my education in lobbying was that it's not who supported the bill, who opposes it. So when we got the School Management Alliance to we met with them, and they agreed, just like with you, agreed not to oppose the bill. And that was a huge win for us, they were not going to oppose it. And so, you know, it went ahead and went through fairly easily. So that helps.
John. The first two bills that we had in Kansas, we had the support of the State School Board Association, not the administrators group. And then they wised up, and for the third bill, then they pulled their support. So it was kind of a, depending upon when the bill was going through, was it determined who was on what side?
Ironic that it succeeded when they were opposed to it and didn't succeed when they supported it.
Yeah.
You know? All right. Well, we need to move on to the next session.
Can I just offer just a couple of quick cleanup things? Just sort of a lobbying primer, if you will, on certain issues. I think the best thing that you can do is to really focus your message. Figure out what your top two things are and just really hone in on that and articulate it as best you can. Find somebody within your community that can articulate it the best and make them the front person. But you really need to do that. It's very, very helpful when you're going to talk to individual members, which is my second point. Identify the committee where the bill is likely to go for its first hearing and really talk to each of the members of that committee about not only your strengths, but your opponent's weaknesses. And I try to address every single argument that your opponents are going to raise and try to beat them to the punch, if you will. And as part of that, I cannot underscore how important it is to talk to the committee consultant who's writing the analysis for your bill and try to get some time to sit down with them and do the exact same thing in a tremendous amount of detail. That's the person that you're probably really going to focus more time on than any member, because they're the ones that are going to be making recommendations to the committee and to whatever caucus controls that committee. And that paid off in spades for us on both sides. That's about it.
That's great. That's really valuable. All right. You know, we're going to do the shift again. So thank you, Jim, Mike, and Senator Yee.